Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on connective tissue. There are four main types of tissue: epithelial, connective, nervous, and muscular. Of these, the most vague and perhaps the least interesting one is connective tissue, but it is super important. It's what's in between all the other types of tissue connecting them. Epithelial tissue has cells without much space between them. Connective tissue, on the other hand, has lesser cells, and they've got spaces between them. That space is filled with a matrix called the extracellular matrix, because it's outside the cells. This extracellular matrix is made up of proteins in the form of fibers and as ground substance. Thus, connective tissue is a combination of these three structures: cells, protein fibers, and ground substance. This connective tissue develops from the mesenchyme, which comes from the mesoderm layer of the embryo. The embryo has three germ layers, and they give rise to all the organs in the body. There's the ectoderm, the mesoderm, and the endoderm. That mesoderm forms the mesenchyme, which contains stem cells, and they can differentiate into different cells that make up connective tissue. So mesenchyme is a type of embryonic connective tissue. The other type is called the mucoid or mucous connective tissue. This is located in the fetal umbilical cord around the umbilical vessels. It's commonly known as Wharton's jelly. Mesenchyme and the mucoid connective tissue are embryonic connective tissue. That's the first type of connective tissue, embryonic connective tissue. The other types of connective tissue are the specialized forms and connective tissue proper. Specialized connective tissue includes bone and cartilage, which are supportive connective tissue, and blood, the fluid connective tissue. Connective tissue proper would be the rest, further divided as loose and dense connective tissue. Loose connective tissue includes areolar tissue, adipose tissue or fat tissue, and reticular connective tissue. Dense connective tissue can be further divided into dense regular and dense irregular connective tissue. Classifications like these usually seem like a lot when you first look at them, but once you learn about each part, you'll find they actually work as excellent summaries. Things like bone, cartilage, blood, adipose tissue, they need separate videos because they are pretty information heavy. But now in this video, we're going to look at some of the features of general connective tissue, and we will return to this classification. Connective tissue has got cells, fibers, and ground substance. First, let's pick up those cells. Now, obviously, specialized connective tissue would have cells with special names, like osteoblasts and osteocytes in bone, chondrocytes in cartilage, adipocytes in adipose tissue. But in general, connective tissue has two groups of cells: those that permanently reside in the tissue, and those that come into the tissue for some purpose, but they come from somewhere else, and they're transient cells. The transient cells are usually immune cells, macrophages, neutrophils, eosinophils, plasma cells, mast cells. Now again, each of these cells would need videos of their own, but very briefly, macrophages are phagocytic scavengers. So they take up debris, foreign substances, and they can have different names depending on their location. For example, dust cells in the alveoli of the lungs, Kupffer cells in the liver, Langerhans cells in the skin. These are all macrophages. But these macrophages are fixed, so they actually are permanent residents. The wandering macrophages are the ones that move around. Those are transient cells. So macrophages could be fixed or transient. The neutrophils are involved in acute inflammation. The eosinophils with allergic reactions and parasitic infections. The plasma cells are modified B lymphocytes, and they produce antibodies. The mast cells, they've got granules, and they're involved in inflammation. For example, in hypersensitivity reactions, mast cells, they degranulate. So from those granules, inflammatory mediators get released. So like this, there are lots of different types of immune cells, and they move into the connective tissue when required to do their job. But the most common cells in connective tissue would be its permanent residents. Like I said before, some cells, like the macrophages and even mast cells, can be permanent. Also stem cells, which give rise to all the other cell types. The most commonly seen one is the fibroblast. The second most common cell is the fibrocyte, and the two are related. The fibroblast isn't just sitting around and doing nothing in connective tissue. There's a reason why it's the most common. Remember the other components of connective tissue? The protein fibers and ground substance. The protein fibers, they include collagen, reticulin, and elastin. The ground substance includes glycosaminoglycans, proteoglycans, and adhesive glycoproteins. Now I know this sounds like a lot, but bear with me, I will get to all of this. But in general, they're all proteins, and they are synthesized by fibroblasts. The fibroblast is an active cell. The blast in it tells you that it's active. It's actively synthesizing stuff, and its appearance reflects that. With lots of branching, lots of rough endoplasmic reticulum, well-defined Golgi apparatus. The fibrocyte, on the other hand, is the second most common. It's not very active. It's a more mature cell. It's spindle-shaped. It's got a less impressive machinery compared to that fibroblast. But that's all about the cells, our permanent residents and transient cells. Next up are the protein fibers. That includes collagen, reticulin, and elastin. These three are distributed in different proportions depending upon what part of the body they're in. Collagen is the most abundant one of the three, and it's almost everywhere, making it the most abundant protein in the body. It's in skin, bone, tendon, cartilage. It's important for strength, tensile strength, and support. That's collagen. Reticulin is a type of collagen, type 3 collagen. It forms a fine meshwork in organs that usually are a part of the reticuloendothelial system. Organs like the spleen, lymph nodes, bone marrow, they have got reticular tissue. The reticulin fibers in these organs are important for structural support. Elastin is elastic. It's stretchy. It can stretch and return to its original shape. Where is that needed? In the lungs, the elastic arteries, some elastic ligaments. And also in skin. Why does pinched skin return to its original state? Elasticity from the elastin fibers in the dermis. Now I'll be talking about these three, particularly collagen, in part 2 of this series. But these fibers, along with the cells, are in the ground substance. The ground substance is made up of carbohydrates and proteins, and they bind to water. So one of the functions of ground substance is hydration. It includes glycosaminoglycans, proteoglycans, and adhesive glycoproteins. Now this stuff can get very heavy in biochemistry, and that can be a little overwhelming. So let's try and keep it simple. To remember these three names, here's a silly and probably inaccurate way to do that, but they're all a mix of carbohydrates and proteins, glycans and proteins, glycosaminoglycans, carbohydrate, protein, carbohydrate. It sounds redundant, but GAG is all you need to remember. The next two look like the same thing, just flipped around. Proteoglycan, flip it around, glycoprotein. Sadly, just because they sound similar does not mean that they are the same. Glycosaminoglycans. These are mucopolysaccharides. The largest is a name that's quite popular, hyaluronic acid. Also called hyaluronan, it's large, it's not sulfated, and it's not attached to proteins. Hyaluronic acid is not covalently attached to proteins, but it's actually attached to proteoglycans, and that will make sense in a bit. It's mostly located in the connective tissue of joints, so it's important for lubrication. It also works like a barrier because it's viscous in nature and doesn't let organisms go from the connective tissue into blood. Now, why did I mention all of this? Because other glycosaminoglycans are smaller, sulfated, and attached to proteins. Four common names: chondroitin sulfate, keratin sulfate, dermatan sulfate, and heparan sulfate. These are located in different parts of the body, for example, dermatan sulfate in the dermis of the skin, heparan sulfate in the basement membrane of the kidney, chondroitin sulfate in bones and joints. But all of these are attached to proteins, and together they form proteoglycan aggregates. Proteoglycans thus have a protein core, and they have glycosaminoglycan side chains. These glycosaminoglycans are the sulfated ones that we saw earlier. Together, they form a proteoglycan monomer. Many of these attach to hyaluronic acid via link proteins, and these form a proteoglycan megacomplex. That's large, and it occupies space, so ground substance occupies space. A few names that you'll see here are perlecan, agrican. Now, these are all proteoglycan aggregates. The last group is the adhesive glycoproteins. They are different. They are adhesive, so they connect stuff. For example, fibronectin. It connects cells to protein fibers. So they act like an adhesive between different components of connective tissue. Thus, we have glycosaminoglycans, proteoglycans, and adhesive glycoproteins forming the ground substance, which is very well hydrated. The fluid that's in the ground substance forms the interstitial fluid outside the cells, so it's a part of the extracellular fluid, and it can exchange with capillaries across the capillary membrane. The forces guiding that exchange are Starling forces. That ground substance, together with the cells and protein fibers, forms connective tissue proper, and depending on their arrangement, we return to that classification. They could be loose or dense. Loose connective tissue, or areolar connective tissue, has lesser cells but more ground substance. The connective tissue fibers are loosely arranged. That's most connective tissue in the body, like the lamina propria, which is situated beneath the epithelial lining of lots of organs. The capsules around organs, all of this is loose connective tissue. It's flexible and is not very resistant to stress. Dense connective tissue, on the other hand, has more fibers and lesser ground substance. It could be irregular or regular. Irregular connective tissue has randomly oriented fibers, hence the name. An example of this would be in the deep dermis of the skin. They are randomly oriented, so they can handle stress and forces that are acting in different directions. The fibers, that's collagen, is what gives them that tensile strength. Dense, regular connective tissue, on the other hand, is more organized. Parallel bundles of fibers, like, for example, in the tendons. Between the fibers, you would see these fibroblasts, because remember, fibroblasts are the ones that synthesize these fibers. But the fibers are parallel, they are not random, so they can handle stresses going in a single direction. All these structures are strong because of those protein fibers. That makes them super important, and we'll go over that in part two. But that's all about connective tissue proper. I do hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.